Hi, my name is Lara Urban. I'm a research fellow at the University of Otago, funded by an Alexander von Humboldt Research Fellowship. I'm currently combining my background from my PhD in statistical genomics at the University of Cambridge with conservation genomics approaches here in Aotearoa, New Zealand. Today, I would like to talk about a very specific project to you, namely about how I applied Oxford Nanopore Technologies adaptive sampling or read-until approach to environmental DNA to monitor the critically endangered kakapo parrot. Environmental DNA, or in short eDNA, is a very powerful approach to monitor biodiversity, not only the endearing kakapo species that you see here on the right side. Because as you will probably know, across the world, wild populations are decreasing at an unprecedented rate. And this is resulting in really huge problems, including environmental, social, economic, cultural problems, like, for example, exacerbated food insecurity and pandemic risk. What is really a problem is that there is not enough quantitative measurements of the biodiversity and of its loss. So this is where eDNA comes in. eDNA provides a scalable, cost-efficient, and non-invasive manner to monitor biodiversity. So eDNA itself is any genetic material that can be extracted from environmental samples. And just to show you a few examples which environmental samples can be used, I show you some of my own research. So for example, we used nanopore sequence to assess the bacterial diversity of the River Kem in Cambridge, UK. We set up various projects to assess the marine biodiversity around New Zealand, and that's what I'm going to present you today. We probed soil samples to monitor a critically endangered flightless bird species. For sure, other material can be used as well, such as sediment, ice core, air, or even feces, urine, hair, or macroinvertebrate bulk samples, whereas the last ones are often not referred to as environmental DNA studies, since there is like some obvious sign of the biological source material available. But let's now talk about our endangered bird species. So the kakapo is a flightless and nocturnal parrot endemic to New Zealand. In New Zealand, the flightless bird species have suffered a lot from the arrival of the human settlers, mainly because of habitat loss, but also because of the introduction of mammalian predators that had previously not been present. This led to the extinction of certain species, such as the moa and the hui, and the kakapo was pushed to the brink of extinction with less than 100 individuals left. And even nowadays, the kakapo remains critically endangered with around 204 individuals left. It is highly inbred with low genetic diversity, and this has led to huge reproduction problems and infertility, as well as increased disease susceptibility. Now, the kakapo has been very lucky that people in the kakapo recovery team of the Department of Conservation here in New Zealand and the Maori iwi or tribes, who are the kaitiaki or guardians of this endangered species, took action and established this really bold recovery program. And I just want to acknowledge these people here, because projects like this would not be possible without them. So all kakapo nowadays live on remote predator-free islands. So if you zoom into New Zealand, here you see like this small island down here, Rakiura. Next to Rakiura, we have Whenuaho, where most of the kakapo live by now. Rakiura itself is the island where most surviving kakapo have been found. And only one additional single male has been found here on the mainland in the remote fjordland. And this male contributed its very valuable genetic diversity to the next generation. So we now set up an environmental DNA monitoring approach together with the recovery team and the Maori iwi to both be able to monitor the future kakapo population when it's going to expand more and more, but also to see if in this remote fjordland area we can find evidence of a remnant population. So I got very lucky to be able to go to Whenuaho in 2019 and sample soil. I will just show you this video very quickly that will help you, hopefully make you appreciate why it makes a lot of sense to sample soil for a kakapo eDNA approach, because it's really completely flightless ground-dwelling bird. So what I did, I took the soil samples, I extracted a DNA using a standard kit, amplified the 12S ribosomal RNA region, then sequenced the amplicons and did taxonomic classification via amplicon sequence variants. And I just very briefly want to show you some results of this study before I actually come to the nanopore part of things. So what we did is we sampled different sites on the islands, such as bowls, which are the mating structures of the kakapo, which are frequented really every night. We have feeding stations that are frequented like a few times a week. And we have old nests that were probably abandoned 1 or 2 months before our sampling process. So this gives us some nice idea about the temporal sensitivity of eDNA. I, in addition, did not only sample the sites, but also at 20 and 4 meters distance, and also took multiple spatial replicates per site so that we would get an idea of the spatial variability. So in the bowls, I showed the example, the results of 2 bowls here. We see that at the center of the bowls, we find a lot of evidence of kakapo DNA, which you see here in the teal color, but the signal is decreasing with distance. At the feeding station, here at one example, you only find evidence of kakapo at the center, directly at the feeding station. And here in another example, you see that even like a spatial replicate of the center does not replicate kakapo DNA, which means that we can only localize kakapo with eDNA in really a highly localized manner. If you look at the old nests, we see that in only one old nest, we find some evidence of kakapo DNA, probably pointing towards a very quick temporal degradation of the DNA. To assess that we would be sensitive enough to only find a kakapo DNA and to not mix it up with any of its close relatives, the kia and the kaka, I also sampled some aviaries in the Dunedin Botanic Garden. where I indeed confirmed that we found evidence of kia and kaka DNA here depicted in gray, but no evidence of kakapo DNA. In addition, in the aviaries, we found DNA of mice, of possums, of exotic birds, where we know they occur in the botanic garden, but they don't occur at Fenuaho. So we really showed that this eDNA process is working nicely. And I just want to mention here that obviously this is by now also possible using nanopore sequencing, especially the portable MIN9 sequencing, as shown by Chulaf et al., who monitored great white shark in the Pacific. Now I wanted to take this eDNA step one step further and go beyond species detection. So I wanted to try if I could do individual identification based on the DNA extracted from the soil samples. But for that, I would obviously have to go beyond just sequencing a ribosomal gene, but I would have to see if I can get as much DNA as possible, ideally, obviously, data from the entire genome. So this is when I started using Oxford Nanopore Technologies adaptive sampling together with the GridION that has a very powerful GPU. As you might know, for this approach, you need a high quality reference, which is available for the kakapo. And as you know, there are lots of initiatives out there that try to create more and more reference genomes in the world, as now also being done by Oxford Nanopore Technologies initiative ORG1. So there have been many great publications about adaptive sampling out there, including like about, you know, the Reed Fish and uncalled approach. But very briefly, what adaptive sampling can do is you can provide certain genomic sequences and can either enrich or deplete for these sequences. Or you can even do it in an adaptive manner based on your intermediate results. So in my case, I wanted to enrich for the 1 gigabases long kakapo reference genome. So here's just an overview of what I was doing. So for data generation, I cleaned up my DNA with a bit cleanup to get rid of the very small fragments, used the ligation sequencing kit, and then loaded the flow cell. And then used a very standard nanopore downstream approach, including Guppy and Porkchop, and then used Minimap2 to align my reads to the kakapo reference genome. So just give you an idea of the output. Here are some statistics about that. And if I plot the reads that were filtered for quality and which adapters were trimmed with Porkchop, they have the following distribution. So you can see that we get a lot of short reads, which in my case is expected because we don't expect too much Kakapo DNA to be contained in these samples. And what we have to know is that with adaptive sampling, still every DNA strand is going to be sequenced for a little bit, for like very roughly 500 bases. So you will have a lot of reads in there, short reads that they actually don't map to your Kakapo reference. If I now look at only the reads that mapped to the reference that you see here, we see two peaks of reads. So we see this one peak over there. These are the reads that were actually that passed the adaptive sampling approach. And then here the orange line is roughly the 500 basis line that I was just talking about. And the reads that are smaller than that are the reads that were too short to even be decided upon if they should be sequenced or not. So I also used these reads and mapped them to the Kakapo reference to get the respective Kakapo specific reads from there. Because as I said before, we are dealing with highly fragmented DNA. So we do expect that quite some of our Kakapo DNA reads will be very, very short. So, and then I moved on to to actually use Medaka for variant calling. And Medaka intrinsically uses WhatsApp for read-based haplotype phasing. And if you combine those two, you can do also the Medaka SNP approach. It will actually extract all possible genotypes in our GVCF files, not only the variants. With this, I ended up with around 26,000 SNPs or variants. And from WhatsApp, I was able to extract nearly 500 haplotypes. Now, as you see, I also had another data set available, and that was a population genomic data set of nearly the entire Kakapo population at the time of sequencing. And these were 169 individuals. So this data set was produced by the Kakapo 125 Plus consortium that I've been involved with for the past years. And I myself was involved in processing and analyzing some of the data. And in this case now, I use the GATK variant caller to call a variance in this data set and ended up with 1.6 million high quality SNPs. And you see that these give me a really nice picture of the general population structure of the Kakapo as shown in this PCA. So I could now combine these SNPs from the population data set with my haplotypes and SNPs from the soil data and overlapped all of those and ended up with 34 haplotypes with overlapping SNPs from both data sets. Oh, with overlapping, I mean overlapping with respect to position and also allele. So I'm working on this haplotype level because my hope was that I would be able to get rid of any sequencing errors like that if I do it in this very stringent way. But let's now proceed to individual identification. So firstly, what I'm plotting here is the percentage of agreement of each Kakapo individual with the soil haplotype set that I just showed you. And you see that the very best hit here is the Kakapo moss. So I now checked back with the metadata that was collected by the recovery team for years, and it has a lot of information about the territories of the Kakapo, and I could indeed confirm that this soil sample had been taken from moss bole. So that was a bit of a eureka moment because at least according to my knowledge, this is the first time that individual identification of a wild animal has been done based on environmental samples. I also used a different approach, Bayesian inference approach that has been used in stock identification, especially like for mixed stock fisheries. But in this case, I used it slightly different. So instead of assigning my data to a population, I tried to assign it to individuals. And so here in this table, what you can see are the mixture proportions in the first column, then the posterior means of the individual assignment in the second column, and the log likelihood in the last column. So that's basically the probability of a certain genotype, given that this genotype, in our case of the soil sample, would fit to a certain individual. And you again see that moss is coming up as our top hit, explaining a lot of the variation that we see in our sample. We also see that Sinbad, another kakapo, is coming up the second hit. And if we go back into my haplotype agreement plot, we also see that Sinbad is the second hit up there. So this made me guess that Sinbad has probably been some sort of contamination, because you do see he is explaining quite a lot of proportion here. Sinbad's territory is not very close to Moss. So this is why I thought about that it might be contamination. And indeed, when I checked back with the kakapo recovery team, shortly before I did all of the soil sampling was when Sinbad was caught a lot for artificial insemination. So there might have been some contamination happening on the way, because of all the human activity on the island, all of the sites are basically connected with each other. So I'm going to dig more into this. Very briefly, I also want to show you the very same a haplotype agreement plot that I just showed you here, but whereas here I only showed them across the 50, or roughly 50 individuals that lived on Fenoahou at that time, here I'm showing the plot across all 169 kakapo that we have genomes of. And what you see here is that Moss actually only is the third best hit. And he was overtaken by the two kakapo, Henry and Marianne. So I was firstly a little bit surprised about that, because I hadn't really heard of Henry and Marianne, and obviously they don't occur in Fenoahou. But I then looked into the kakapo pedigree, and I found that actually both Moss and Sinbad are uncles of Henry and Marianne. So what happened here is that Henry and Marianne are combining gene pool of our two best hits, and are like this ending up as an even better hit. But this is probably something that is expected to be observed in a highly inbred population. I briefly want to show you the results of two other soil samples that I sequenced on the gridiron. The first one is Merv's bowl. So Merv actually ended up as the second hit, and you've probably guessed it, the best hit again is Sinbad, and the Bayesian inference approach again agrees with that. Nora's feeding station, very same thing, Sinbad is the very best hit, also confirmed by the Bayesian inference approach, where Sinbad even reaches a posterior individual assignment of one. So this really strengthened my hypothesis that Sinbad was contaminating. In addition, what I haven't told you beforehand, what is really interesting as well, that Moss and Sinbad in the previous example, and here Merv and Sinbad, also together explain all the genetic variant that we find in the respective soil sample. So it's really likely that Sinbad is just contaminating here. In Nora's feeding station, I wasn't really able to disentangle the presence of any specific kakapo, but it is known to be quite a hotspot of different kakapo passing by and trying to visit Nora for mating. So it might just be that we have like a mixture of different kakapo DNA at that spot. So in this pilot study, I hope that I was able to show that individual identification using adaptive sampling on environmental DNA is possible. But obviously we want to take this step even this approach even one step further, because what we really want to understand about an endangered species is its genetic structure, its relatedness structure. We want to understand inbreeding and maybe even be able to assess fitness-related phenotypes, which is thinking further into the future, because you would need quite some coverage of your genome to be able to achieve this, especially for polygenic traits. But I'm hopeful that if the adaptive sampling approach is getting better and better, we can actually extract as much DNA as possible from these environmental samples. If you are interested in like the fitness related studies of the kakapo, I've done quite a lot of quantitative genomic approaches and applied them to the species as well. And I just presented these results last week at the Cold Spring Harbor, a Biology of Genomes conference, which should hopefully be available online soon. Now, the kakapo is obviously a very easy example to do this study, because a lot of data is available on it already. So I just very briefly want to show you a real world application of this. So I also study another endangered flightless bird endemic to New Zealand, the takahe rail. So what I did within a little bit more than a year is I established the takahe genomics project, again in collaboration with Maori Iwi and the recovery program. I got all the necessary funding, went into the wild, got blood samples, created a reference genome together with the Vertebrate Genomes Project, identified more individuals that we would have to sequence to understand the entire population genetic variants, got more 84 more blood samples and sequenced those, and like this got a nice overview of the general genetic diversity of the population. So there's one more problem in the Takahe, in that there is only one wild population left, and this is down here in the Fjordland again that you've already heard about. In the Fjordland, we have the problem that it's so remote and rugged, it's really hard to assess and catch birds. So we don't really know which genetic variation is left in these wild populations that we have might have not have captured by any of the sanctuaries yet. So, but instead of now going out and trying in a dangerous way to capture all of these birds, what we did is we went out there and collected fecal samples. And we are now going to try the same approach using adaptive sampling, extracting Takahe specific DNA from these fecal samples and trying to see if we find any important genetic variations out there in the wild that, as said, are not yet protected in the sanctuaries. So I've now sequenced four different Takahe fecal samples like that and get quite a lot of data out of it, but please stay tuned for these results. Also, we really want to take this adaptive sampling approach into the field. So I teamed up with these two amazing researchers, Cho and Miles. Cho has a lot of experience with using DNA extraction and MININE sequencing in general in the field, as you see here, where she's sequencing a cassava virus in Africa. And Miles has now trialed, I think by now successfully, to bring adaptive sampling into the field using powerful NVIDIA GPUs and a solar panel to actually power the whole application. So please stay tuned for more results to come from Aotearoa New Zealand, because we don't only want to apply these approaches to actually monitor the endangered species, but also to, for example, follow up on certain pathogens that have been dangerous for the population during the last years. So with this, I would like to thank again, especially the recovery teams and the Maori Iwi, but also some people of my group here at Otago, then multiple other Kiwi collaborators, and for sure, all of the funding bodies. So thank you very much for your attention.